I'm Finn.
I'm Sorry.
That's Booby.
And Jumpy and Ghosty.
I'm gonna turn the light to something different color. Where did it go? What's going on, ladies and gentlemen?
I have no idea
this,
what it is.
This is Skeleton on Your Shoulder by the band Coronar. It looks like an 80s band, huh?
Yeah.
Punishment and Decadence is the name of the record. This is from the Extreme Underground.
Yes.
The XU. The XU is a Patreon alliance.
Yep.
$1 at the gate. Gets you in with a bunch of your teammates and basically like-minded as far as the similar genres, but
yeah,
there's also a community and all that jazz. It's really, really awesome stuff. So that's my favorite way to get a song reviewed. Of course, there's a $75 option and the old school option, which is, hey man, send us an email. We'll make it happen for you, inshallah. Now, for timely topical political commentary, you can hit us up at Middle America with Vint and Sori. I think we got a lot of... We're expanding a little bit of the format, bringing on some guests and things of that nature. Some we agree with, some that we don't, and so it should be fun.
That's what makes it interesting.
Yep. We've got Middle America with Vin and Sori. Also, if you like...
The link's in the description also for that.
If you like this channel, there's also another channel called Nuclear Reactions from the big homie Blake.
Yep.
You should, if you haven't subscribed to that channel, you need to subscribe right now. You're too late. Okay. So let's do it. Skeleton on Your Shoulder Corner. Let's go.
All right, go.
Fast. That was seamless. Some pretty ridiculous musicianship. It was that's a straight up old school thrash song right there. Thrash, thrash, thrash. Good night. They had some sort of like they were deathy type vocals, which I think I don't know, was that a little bit revolutionary for being 1988? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm not really sure.
I think 80s bands with, you know, it was like, well, Slayer, but you know, Tom Araya didn't really use death vocals. He used like a ominous tone, but it wasn't like rah, like, so I don't know. I thoroughly enjoyed the musicianship here, man. Like this they had some really smooth transitions and just really, really heavy stuff. Did you not like you're not a big thrash person, I don't think. I don't think you're very big into thrash metal.
Is that
thrash.
Well, I get that it's thrash. It's hard for me to like piece together sometimes, like if something's in a, I'm like, every time that this group comes, like the EU, do I always not like their song? I hope not. You know, but I'm just gonna tell you honestly, I didn't really like it.
And
it
what?
Was like, no.
How could you not like it?
I didn't. It was, it seemed like it was boring, actually, to be honest.
What?
Some of the musicianship I thought was good, and I liked it, but then it was like, just didn't feel like the lyrics were going anywhere. Like, okay, there's a skeleton that's on their shoulder.
Well, if you took the three times the choruses went
four.
Out.
Four. Oh, no, it is
the
three.
Lyrics are a bit
like
sparse, but what did you think the skeleton on your shoulder was?
I have no idea. I don't know.
So, you know, I think it's playing on the whole everybody has an angel and a demon on their shoulder.
Well, that's the only thing that came to mind was the devil and the angel and the wand.
Right, but here he's talking about skeleton, and I think it's talking about
death.
Like the lure of death, because he's saying, you've had enough of all the waste around you, now you want to travel another path. If you wish to see a different view, come into my deadly arms, let the mist cover you. And then it says, we'll drift through the universe.
Yep.
You know, no more responsibility high above the clouds of reality. So I just think it's about, like,
I taste as sweet as honey, but I'm dangerous like a snake.
Right.
Yep.
It's sort of this provocative nature of, you know, the ultimate escape, you could say. People think that, you know, this is going to help you escape, whatever. But it comes with a lot of baggage and pain that for the people left behind. So even if, theoretically, and I'm not particularly sure, that you're going to be free of any responsibility, you know.
No.
When you go into the next world. But, yeah, it's this very, very provocative thing where people want to escape, you know. I think everybody's had that feeling. I'm not saying everybody's suicidal, obviously not. I don't think everybody's suicidal, but I think everybody's just kind of been like, man, you know, things would be a lot.
Things could be a little simpler than this.
Right. And I think the difference between somebody that's there and then somebody that's in trouble is the ideation or the obsessive sort of idea around it.
Yeah.
where, you know, that really becomes dangerous for a person versus just like a fleeting thought where they go, nah, I'll figure out a way to solve this problem.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
I think too that sometimes people confuse, well, I don't know. It's weird because I was going to say, I think sometimes people confuse death with peace. Like, I think that people are seeking for peace,
right,
and so they assume that death will bring them peace.
Right.
Because death is something that they haven't experienced, and, you know, when you see someone that's dead, they're not, you know, so you don't really know, you know? So think, right, a lot of it. But then I think we still question it, which is why we say rest in peace, because isn't that kind of like a good will toward, a good wish toward the person that has died, RIP?
Yeah, yeah.
Or is it that we definitively know? Like, to me, I always took that as, you know, I want you to rest in peace. Like, why would you say that if you knew definitively that they were? You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know if we're, yeah, completely. So anyway, I think that that's what happens. Yeah. Is people confuse that. And so that can, in a lot of different circumstances, make you think, whew, it'd be easier if I was dead. But you don't necessarily mean dead. Sometimes it's just, like, if I had a bit of peace,
right,
this would be easier. Right.
That's what everybody's really gunning for.
Yeah.
Is peace. Like, I... But the message is a very good message then, because the death is not...
Right.
And suicide is not being portrayed as something positive.
Right.
Which has always been a struggle for balance in the metal community when you're talking about suicide. On the one hand, you want to be as honest and raw and as real with your art as possible. But then on the other hand,
you don't want to encourage anything.
And again, it's the obsessiveness, I think, that gets people, or you know, it's one of those things where if you experience something mega traumatic and you have that thought in your head, like, that's not crazy. But if the space between the thoughts, the fleeting thoughts start getting smaller and smaller, you're also in trouble. So, for example, like, if it, you know, you were fine the whole year and some horrible thing happened to somebody in your family, and you get that type of thought, like, that makes sense. Like, that's just human experience. But if it goes from once a year, you know, one time in a year to four times in a year, and then the next year it's 58 times in a year, now you're starting to get in trouble where you have these thoughts of, oh, I need to get out of here.
Do you think that there's some people that's just kind of like, you know,
kind of
who they are. You know what I mean? Like,
I don't think that's who people are. I just think it, you know, Peterson talked about it, the burden of being and the burden of having responsibilities. I mean, that's one of the markers of adulthood.
Yeah.
Is this taking on of responsibility. But, you know, when Peterson talks about the burden, it's like, whoa, that's a very good point. It is very, very burdensome to exist in the world. And it doesn't matter where you are, who you are. Like, America is one of the richest countries on the planet. We also have an extremely high suicide rate. Yeah. So, I don't think that people are just disposed to being suicidal all their life. I do think that some people are disposed to, you know, melancholy, as Jonathan Edwards would say. Like, people are just sad, you know, and obviously we know there's chemical, whatever. Or, you know, we assume, based on what the, you know, science tells us, but I don't think there's people that with a blank slate have suicidal ideation. And I've run into people pretty much all my life who say, oh, I've thought this way all my life.
Yeah.
And so, okay. I mean, if you say so. I mean, I think that they're...
I don't understand what you're saying. What do you mean if you say so? You think that they're lying to you, that they haven't had those thoughts all their life? Well, or you're saying that it came in varying degrees? I don't understand what you're saying.
I don't think they're lying, per se. I think there's a difference between experiential truth and lived truth. And I think those are not the same thing. So when you're in that state of mind, everything becomes, you know, universal.
Yeah.
You know, so when you're in a state of mind, when people said that to me, they're in a state of, you know, despair themselves, and they're saying this, you know, I've always felt this way. And like I said,
if
you say so, but I'm not convinced that people start off that way.
Well, I just, who knows, maybe this is something really terrible and destructive to say, I don't really know. But, like, I think that some people, you know, when they get stressed out, they think, oh, I need to go get a cigarette. Some people get stressed out, they're like, I gotta drink. or some people go have sex. Some people, you know, there's all kinds of different ways that people deal with frustration and stress and anxieties and different things like that. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's some people that the thought of suicide is kind of like their thing that they, I'm not saying that it's a healthy thing to do, but like that type of person that could come to, there's a lot of, there's a lot of times somebody can get stressed in a day or a week or, you know what I mean? Or are you saying that somebody that has, if that's their kind of like go-to thought.
Well, even in the analogy, the person wasn't born with a beer or a joint in his mouth.
I wasn't trying to communicate that somebody was born that way.
I'm not saying that. You're saying, that is a reaction to certain stressors.
Of course, yeah.
So, but that's a behavior the person contracted, and that, yep. That's what I'm saying about suicide. Even if you're using it as an escape, I don't think that like a 2-year-old is walking around thinking, "Oh, I'd be better off if I was dead."
No,
I took away his truck or whatever. That's what I'm saying. So like, I don't think that people are born, you know, at that level.
That's not what I was saying.
I just think that people, it's a contracted defense mechanism that they have,
and yeah.
They, you know, it's a habit of the mind, is what I'm saying. I don't think that people start off that way or they're just born that way. I just think people, that's how people handle different stresses in their life.
Do you think that, you know, like they'll say, well, who's they? I don't know who they is. I just know that I've heard it said that, you know, like, women will think about cheating, I don't know, it was like thousands of times before they actually go out and actually right. cheat. And that men think about it, I think, less before they go out and do it or something.
That's very believable.
Why?
Well, just the nature of men and women. But.
Yeah. Oh, anyway, so would you, like, do you think that the person that has that thought where it's kind of like their escape pod, you know what I mean? Like, they're not thinking that they're going to do that, but that's kind of like, it's not like they're like, something bad happens and then they're like, let me think of an escape. Oh, I could kill myself. It's not like that. It's just like, it just happens. Like, you know, something happens and then they just think about.
I think things happen that way because of, you know, muscle memory. Whatever you practice in a stressful situation is what you're going to fall back on without thinking. And that's why, you know, like in the military, you drill over and over and over again on the same thing over and over again, so that when you're in a high stress situation, you're not thinking about.
That's not
about,
your go-to.
You're not. No, it's yeah. It is your go-to.
No,
you're
just I see not, what you're saying.
You're just not thinking I'm about it. So if if you've got a person who, you know, escapism is their thing over and over and over again, what I'm saying is at the beginning they're making a conscious choice to go in that direction, and then after a while, after you've trained your brain, your mind, whatever you want to call it, to think that way all the time when you're under stress, and of course you're going to do it without thinking.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
So,
well, I was going to say, like, is the theory true? Like, is it that you thought about cheating 1,000 or 2,000 times before you actually did, or is it that you were already going to cheat and it just so happened you did a lot of thinking about it before it happened? Did the thinking about it bring it about? Or was it already going to happen in the thinking about it? You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
So
yeah.
I was going to ask the same question, what you thought about that. Like, do you think that the person that thinks like that all the time, it's inevitably going to happen to that, not inevitably, but more than likely, you know, does it push the person closer toward the edge of actually committing, you know, that act? Or is it just, you know?
No, that's where I'm at. I think people unwittingly kind of lock themselves into a corner with this stuff when you start, you know, fantasizing about it and yada, 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 instead of coming up with very concrete, practical, healthy ways to
situation. I think you're right.
So, but I don't think, you know, it's not an immutable trait, you know, so it's something that can be changed. But a lot of times when you're in the throes of depression, like, it's very, very hard to parcel things out rationally.
Because
the majority of the energy that you're spending is to stay alive.
Right.
You know, and that's what a lot of people don't understand with these types of situations. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah, but I agree. The course is a little bit repetitive, obviously, but I think this is one of these, like, cautionary tales where it's like, don't listen to that.
Yeah.
Sort of whatever. And I think that that's, it's good. You know, finally we had a song that's, you know, against it and not promoting it per se. But good Lord, what do you give the song?
Okay, so it was like super low for me. It was going like at a 6. The conversation I think is really good because I think it's a very important topic, and I think that, that what you said was true, and I think that that's good for people to realize that if you have, if your mind negatively kind of goes toward those thoughts or whatever, and that's like your go-to to deal with certain situations, or it helps you deal with the loss, certain losses or whatever, then you have to retrain your mind to not go there. So yeah, you have to know, hey, this type of situation triggers that mindset and that thought process. So whenever I get in that situation, know that's where your mind is going to go, and actually get yourself redirected on some a healthier, you know, a healthy way, you know, of dealing with that rather than that.
Well, yeah, and I think one of the clearest, one of the best weapons that we have, or the first step to in that direction of creating that new habit and all that, is just creating the habit of being open with people and letting them know that, hey, I'm having a hard time, blah, blah, blah. Like, that's extremely important. You know, that's what gives you, you know, you, these things are too much, you know, the burden of existence, as Edwards would say, is too much for one person to carry. It just is, you know? And so I think, you know, being able to have people that you can talk to and things of that nature, obviously, I think it's a lot more complicated than that. Hey, you're suicidal ideation? Just get a bunch of friends. I'm not saying that that's the solve for everything, but it's a step in the right direction, and it's one way that you can gauge yourself as to how serious you are about, you know, beating this thing and creating new pathways in your mind so that you default to something else.
And I mean, I think that's something, you know, I mean, obviously we're Christians, so we're going to, you know, we're going to lean in the direction toward, you know, prayer or different things like that. Like, but I actually, believe it or not, I think that when I've been in situations like that, just like sitting stationary and praying has been hard for me. So it was easier to like go, either go for a walk or go running if, you know, if you're physically able to run. If not, like acclimating your body to get stronger and stronger until you can run, because something about getting out some of that energy and the endorphins that come from exercising is actually, it really helps you. So it's just natural and it can kind of make you feel a bit better. So you will have gotten some positive energy for your body and just, you know, health benefits. And then at the same time, you know, creating a new pattern of thought and then a new go-to. So then the next time that you get stressed or feel super, you know, at loss or whatever it is that is your reason that kind of brings you to that, you're like, oh, I'm going to go for a run. You know, it's a much healthier response than thinking about something you don't intend to do, but is comforting to you. So.
Good call.
So what is this for you?
The 9.4 from A.
Yeah, it's, sound-wise, it's like a 6. Topic-wise, I'll bring it to an 8.5.
There you are, dear listener. If you're in that type of trouble, I am sure that you may think you're alone, but I'm sure you've got a friend or two around that would love to be part of the walking through process. So I would commend that to you.
And there's, you know, 1-800 numbers that you can call that are 24/7. You know, you can get right on the line with somebody. And if you don't have friends around, you don't have somebody that you can call or nobody that you can trust, like, you, those are places that you can call. They're confidential, right?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
Okay, well, I don't know that either.
I've never called one of them. So, I mean, I don't know. and I'm not particularly sure that we want it to be confidential.
Right. Yeah, I see what you're saying. I'm just telling you to breathe?
Yeah.
Are you holding your breath? Or is it just like finishing your
breathing? No, I just think, I set up a program or something that's supposed to breathe. So. There you are, Dale. Listen up. Vin out.
Sorry, out.
Gone.